Hi again, everybody. Welcome to Inside Golf. I'm Harry Donahue, and yes, we're back at Atlantic City Country Club. Here's the bell in Northfield, New Jersey, the historic Atlantic City Country Club. Today, we're going to be telling some great golf stories about Atlantic City and golf in the Philadelphia area in general. You know, Jack Nicklaus once said, it's great for a youngster to grow up on a golf course because it teaches them how to behave. Well, today we're going to be talking to the sons of the great Leo Frazier, who owned Atlantic City Country Club going back to the mid-40s. Later, he went on to become the president of the PGA of America, and he attracted an assortment of celebrities and characters here to Atlantic City Country Club. And joining the Fraziers will be Bob Shepard, no stranger to Inside Golf. And like Doug and Jim Frazier, he was the son of a PGA professional. Stories of golf in Philadelphia and here at Atlantic City Country Club. Up next on Inside Golf.
Inside Golf, now celebrating its 20th season, is presented by Destination Monco Golf. 54 courses, 300,000 yards. Check them out at montcogolf.com. By the First Tee of Philadelphia. The First Tee helps young men and women become better golfers, but most important, better people. Get involved. Visit thefirsttphiladelphia.org. By the Golf Association of Philadelphia. GAP, celebrating amateur golf since 1897. By Jersey Man Magazine. It's a Jersey way of life. And by Philly Man Magazine, bringing it to Broad Street. And by Inside Golf's partner since 1998, the Philadelphia Section PGA, experts in the game and business of golf. Take time to thank your local PGA golf professional.
Along with being stewards of the game of golf, your local PGA professional wears many hats.
We are teachers.
We are players.
We are managers.
We are merchandisers.
And community leaders.
But we all wear one badge.
PGA professionals are well-trained experts who work hard to share the joy of golf with our neighbors for over 90 years. To find your local PGA professional, visit phillypga.com. Brought to you by the Philadelphia section of the PGA.
We are the experts in the game and business of golf.
My mom asked, Caitlin, would you like to do golf? And I said, sure. And so I got into it.
I watched it on TV one day and I was like, yeah, I gotta try that one day. And I was like, yeah, I need you to do something over the summer.
Well, my grandfather played golf and then he kind of gave me the interest in playing golf.
My dad told me about it and I thought it was interesting, so I tried it out. I really liked it, so I went on.
Welcome back to Inside Golf. We are at the historic Atlantic City Country Club in Northfield, New Jersey. And of course, we're sitting here in the Leo Frazier room. Leo Frazier owned Atlantic City Country Club starting back in the mid-40s. He went on to become the iconic head of the PGA of America in the late 60s. And boy, if these walls could talk to us, imagine all the stories we would get. The celebrities from the world of sports, from politics, from entertainment. We've done better than that. We have two gentlemen here, the sons of Leo Frazier, and we also have Bob Shepard, who used to hang around here a little bit. Bob's father was a pro golfer, Len Shepard, in the Philadelphia area. Good friends with Leo, as Bob was. But let's introduce our panel. And no strangers, really, now, because Doug Frazier has been part of Inside Golf on our teed-off segments. Jim Frazier's making his debut.
Yes,
Jim,
thank you.
Thanks for joining us. And, of course, we all know Mr. Bob Shepard. All right, gentlemen, I kind of put the ball on the tee a little bit for you guys. They hit it straight down the middle. Let's start with the Frazier brothers. We are privileged to be here at a spot that was your home. When you were growing up, you guys walked around here. This was your house. This was your playground, right, Dougie?
Yes, it was. But it was a lot of fun. But, you know, Pop was a hell of a taskmaster, so we all worked quite hard here.
All right. Jimmy, some of your fond early memories of being here at Atlantic City Country Club, not to mention the people you ran into, in later life you probably came to appreciate that a little bit more.
Well, I mean, geez, so many memories, and I'm a little older than Doug, so I can remember just starting at the men's locker room, opening the doors, running as fast as I can into the main dining room, which is still there, and sliding on the wood floor down the...
And your father wouldn't be around, him, otherwise...
Until I got a
like
big splinter.
Like Doug said, he was a taskmaster.
Until I got a big splinter in my leg, then I couldn't do that anymore. But it's where we grew up. It was our home. We were very, very lucky. We could come in here and get breakfast. Although, as for myself, I would rather go over to the caddy yard because I thought the food was better over there.
Okay, we won't tell anybody. We won't tell anybody in the kitchen. Bobby, one thing you share, as I said, with the Frazier brothers is the fact that you both had fathers who were professionals.
Yes.
Your dad, Len Shepard, for years in the Philadelphia section. At what point did you think that maybe a professional career would be something you'd like to pursue?
Well, you know, Dougie and I, and Jimmy too, we played junior golf together. I mean, we had the inner city club team matches here. Atlantic City was a big part of life in any pro's existence in Philadelphia.
This is
the place. I mean, it's so when you're a kid and you're growing up and you're everybody is your envy, it gets to the point where you say, you know what, I want to be there too one time. I want to be the guy that's giving the kid the junior lessons and not charging them. I want to be the guy that overtips the caddy that does a good job. And you just sort of fall into it as you go. It's an attrition. You take your time with it, but you never really know that's where you're going until you get there.
Right.
So it's a mystical existence, really. Golf is, and as we were just saying, too, I mean, these walls are full of people that today's generation don't even know. They don't know the names or what they did or what they've achieved.
And yet, such a big part of golf, not just in Philadelphia, South Jersey, but golf internationally. I mean, you know, you look at the walls around here, you see a photograph of Ben Hogan, Jim, from 1942.
Right.
Ben Hogan was just, you know, coming onto the scene, and he was 30 years old at that time.
And, you know, my dad did not own it at the time. It was a professional event here, and somewhere... Someone has the pictures, the film of that, and I have to try to find that. It may be my brother-in-law, but they played a tournament here. I don't think Hogan won, but I remember the pictures of him slashing at the ball. You know, in those days, he didn't have that short, compact swing. But, he and many others. And Hogan came back and was a great friend of my dad, and they played an exhibition over 2 days to raise money for charity.
Yeah, Dougie, you were telling us that story a couple weeks ago, and Mr. Hogan was kind enough to turn back the winner's check, right?
Yes. Actually, they gave him a $5,000 fee he had asked for to come and play an exhibition.
Sort of like an appearance fee?
An appearance fee. He didn't do a lot of exhibitions. He never did. As a favor to my dad, he said, I'll come. That's it. Now, afterwards, my dad had the check, took him to the airport. Before they left, he took the check, crossed out his name, and put the charity. I think it was a Boys and Girls Clubs, wrote it on there, Boys and Girls Clubs. And he said to my dad, "You don't have to tell anybody I did this."
And he didn't. Yeah, that's
true
an
story.
Amazing story.
Yeah.
At what point, Jim, did you realize, and Doug chime in too as well? You know, you'd see Jackie Gleason in here. You know, you see Bob Hope in here. At what point did you just figure, my dad must be a pretty big-time guy?
That's an interesting question. I, as a little boy, I don't think I really thought much of it because there was always someone people thought were famous were coming here. And honestly, from the time I was 10 and my brother also, we were working doing something, whether it was picking crabgrass, caddying, which was what I loved to do because I could make some money, raking sand traps. So
washing dishes.
Yeah.
You did it all.
We did pretty much everything you could ever do. And I will say this, washing pots was one of the things I pretty much refused to do. I could tell a story about making him wash the pots one day.
Well, that's what you get for sliding across the dining room floor, right? Yeah. If you hadn't done that, maybe the pots would have been Dougie's job, but who knows?
But I would have to say that Bob Hope, by the time he started coming around quite a bit, as I got older, I did realize, you know, this he was really some man and wonderful
special man.
Special man.
And special for the game of golf. All right, we're going to take a break, and we'll be back with the Fraziers and with Bob Shepard. as we continue to tell some stories of golf from the not too distant past. Depends on how old you are, but boy, what a past it was. Right here at Atlantic City Country Club and around the Philadelphia area. Stay with us. More stories coming up on Inside Golf.
The Frazier family had ties to golf in the region that date back to 1960.
Oh no!
What?
Mandy keeps sending me pictures of the girls' shopping trip to Monco.
Why did you tell him you couldn't go again?
Because I told him that we needed to catch up on housework.
Jersey Man and Philly Man magazine, published by former Eagles tight end Ken Dunnick, is everything you want in a publication catering to men's interest. Enjoy articles on politics, business, the mob, wine, food, fitness, and travel. Written by the likes of George Anastasia, Bill Lyon, Sam Carcitti, and Mike Kern. Want to grow your business? Ask for information on our legacy and chairman clubs. They meet regularly and can be a valuable tool for your company. Subscriptions are only $20 a year for 6 issues. They're available at JerseyManMagazine.com.
Welcome back. Inside Golf continues today from the historic Atlantic City Country Club. We are seated right now in the Leo Frazier Room right off the lobby at Atlantic City. And we're joined by two of Leo's sons, Doug Frazier, Jim Frazier, and Bob Shepard, who was a very good friend of the Frazier family growing up. And Bobby, let's pick up. We just heard from the Fraziers talking about the celebrities that they became familiar with as young boys from just coming to Atlantic City Country Club. Your dad, Len, was a professional in the Philadelphia area.
North Hills.
But he actually worked under the great, the legendary bon vivant Walter Hagen.
Right.
What was that? What? How did that all happen?
Well, it's a funny story, and I'm going to cut it short a little bit. But when I was in elementary school, a lot of the teachers would have you write articles on what your grandparents or what your parents or grandparents were doing during the Depression.
Sure.
And I went home and asked my dad, "What were you doing during the Depression?" And he said, "Well, I was drinking champagne, eating caviar, driving around in Rolls Royces."
Typical Depression existence,
right?
Huh?
And he said, things were pretty good for those few years. So anyway, I went to school and I submitted the paper, and the teacher came over and said, "I'd like to see you after class." And said, "Now I'd like to see your dad come in here." So in comes my dad, and of course he confirms everything. He said, "Yeah," he said, he was very good friends with Walter Hagen, and not Walter Hagen Jr., but he could pick the phone up and make the call. And of course, in the later years, there wasn't much to pick up and call about. But I met Walter Jr. I met Walter. I went out to Traverse City to, I had a personal goal. I wanted to see where Walter spent his retirement money. And I went to this little pub in the corner of the street, which is now like a shot in a beer bar. But he used to go there, and the bartender knew him, believe it or not. It was unbelievable. He said, "Oh, Walter used to sit at that chair right there every day."
Amazing.
That was amazing.
Walter Hagen, I mean, for some of our younger viewers, I guess to put it in perspective, Walter Hagen was bigger than Babe Ruth back in the 20s. He was bigger than Bobby Jones in golf because
right.
Jones really hadn't come on the scene yet. So that's what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
And you guys, your father got a job, right, from Walter Hagen to get his career started, Doug.
Yeah, in 1927, my father went to Plum Hollow in Detroit to work as a young assistant pro. And he had caddied for Hagen in an exhibition at Seaview, where he grew up, right here in Abseek in Atlantic City area. That was 3 or 4 years before. Hagen was pretty strong in the golf business, especially in Michigan. After he helped him get the job there at Plum Hollow as a young assistant, then he went to Saginaw Country Club for his first head job in 1930, and that was because of Walter Hagen's recommendation.
So that's a little history of Walter Hagen. We're talking about some other celebrities and well-known golfers here. We talked about Hogan coming here, Jim, and you told me you had a picture of yourself as a youngster with Gene Sarazen on the first tee here at Atlantic City.
I wish I would have bought it today, but it's in my home. It's a picture. I was probably 5 years old on the first tee. I'm not sure why Gene Sarazen was here, but the thing that struck me about it, I had my hat, my cap on turned backwards, which they do today.
And, you look like Ricky Fowler.
No, I wouldn't say that. But Gene was adjusting the ball, and I had my finger on top of the golf ball. And then years later, my youngest son, I did the same picture with him, although I wasn't Gene Sarison, but it was the same picture.
It's amazing. You know, like I say, if these walls could talk, the stories that would come out of it. Bob, do you remember the first time you played here at Atlantic City? What was the event, a junior match?
No, it was actually not the first time I was here, but the first competitive round I ever played was here. Well, actually it wasn't. It was at WIP tournament up at Galen Hall.
Okay.
With Pete Retzlaff and Jim Leeming and the KYW team, or the WIP team.
Right.
And then I came here for the inter-city team matches, which were played amongst four different cities in the coast. And I think you played in them too, Doug. I have a picture of us. I believe it on the first tee also. Maybe it was the 10th, but it was. We had a great time as kids, didn't we?
Oh.
We were competitive. We weren't hugging each other.
Thing Bob said that is so true about why we all love this game for many, many reasons. But what Bob's dad told him about the caviar and champagne, a lot of, you know, my dad's mission in life, they all think that the greatest thing he ever did was Atlantic City Country Club. His mission in life was to raise the stature of the PGA professional. But having said that, a lot of PGA professionals didn't then and don't now make a lot of money, but it's still a pretty nice life. You get to hang around with a lot of good people and maybe not have a champagne all the time or caviar, but you live pretty good.
It was a different era.
You play your cards right, yeah.
Well, before, we got about a minute left here in this segment, and Bob, you told me a story as we were coming down from the city today to be with the Frasers here about a Mike Douglas tournament. Doug, do you remember this?
Yes, I do.
Mike Douglas, of course, did a nationally syndicated TV show out of the studios of KYW Channel 3 right at 5th and Market, and they had an event here, and Shep, you couldn't even get in the front door. No. Dougie had to come to your rescue. Do you remember this story?
I remember the tournament. I don't remember that story.
I pulled in, they wouldn't let me in.
Tell us about it.
He had knickers on. He was ready to go.
I got ready to play. The guy said, I don't know you. I said, well, you don't have to know me. I just got to get to that first tee in about 10 minutes. So I went out, and I won the darn thing.
Did you win the thing?
Yeah, I won it. Great. And,
there were some good players in that. There were some good players in there, some tour players.
Celebrity pro-am like?
Yeah. They had, who was it, the comedian I mentioned?
Henny Youngman.
He was the MC afterwards.
Oh, it's hysterical.
I'll tell you.
Take my wife, please.
Exactly. That's the sort of history we're talking about with these three gentlemen here at Atlantic City Country Club. And the stories go on, and we're going to tell some more of them. Stay with us. More to come here on Inside Golf, stories of golf in South Jersey and Philadelphia, with the Frasers and our good friend, Bob Shepard. Stay with us here on Inside Golf.
Here's Leo, and that turns into a standing ovation.
Welcome back to Inside Golf from Atlantic City Country Club. Specifically, we're in the Leo Frasier room, and we're talking to Leo's sons, Doug and Jim, and Bob Shepard, just telling some golf stories about this historic place and beyond. All right, let's pick up a story that you once told me with the Frasier boys' father, Leo. It wasn't here. It was across the pond at Troon.
Troon, 18, I think it was the 82 Open, and we were in the merchandise show, and Dougie and Jimmy wasn't there, but his dad was there, and his dad wasn't feeling real chipper.
A little under the weather?
A little under the weather, and with a cold afternoon, with the wind blowing and stuff, it was probably a good idea for him to head home. And Dougie had nothing else to do, I guess, and you took off for some parties up in Edinburgh somewhere.
So. He doesn't remember that.
No, he's on motorcycle.
That happened a lot. He doesn't.
I probably did.
That's right. So anyhow, I got over to the house, and I asked my host if it would be possible to get Leo over. So he said, sure, just call him and tell him the address. And so I called him, I said, Leo, I'll come over and pick you up. He said, no, he said, I'll take a taxi. So I said, okay, well, here's the thing. The taxi pulled up, I opened the door, he came in, I gave him a handshake, introduced him to Gordon and Margaret Taylor, whose house this dinner was at, and unbeknownst to me when I invited him, it was for the International Press Corps. So we had all the big time press from Japan and Switzerland and Italy and everywhere. Anyhow, in he comes, and as he walks through the door, the great room where they're having the cocktails goes silent, and all of a sudden breaks out into an applause, and then it turns into a standing ovation. Everybody stood up, and here's Leo. He has no idea what he's doing. Your dad, all of a sudden he's the guest. It was my guest just to have dinner, and here he goes, the guest of honor.
So, and he put on a show for an hour or so.
Oh my God.
Telling stories.
Telling stories, and when he left, everybody went outside to watch the cab take him. He wouldn't let me get him home. And my friend had, you know, a Jaguar. He could have gone home, but he went home in a taxi cab.
So great story.
Atlantic City Country Club, as I said, your dad took over Atlantic City in mid-40s, and then became the president of the PGA of America in the late 60s. There were so many constant visitors here. It was like, you know, a revolving door, Doug. Some of the characters, though, that a lot of people may not know about, and one of them in particular, George Lowe.
Yeah, we had a lot of characters, from George Lowe to Evel Knievel to Bobby Riggs to actors, Vic Damone, Jerry Lewis. But George Lowe, rock on tour, the famous putting guru. And
everybody went for him
on
tour.
And the biggest mooch of all time, by the way, biggest freeloader.
He came here for how long?
He came here. My dad invited him in for a week. He wanted to give some lessons, and he stayed 13 years.
That's all.
Every summer he'd show up again. We'd have to feed him.
He had a chair for him right here at the grill?
Yes, sir. Chair in the grill, right in the pro shop. Henri to everybody. Loved my dad, but Henri to everybody. But he was my dad's friend.
But if
friend.
You bought him a drink, he wasn't that ornery.
And he got bought a lot of drinks,
yeah.
Trust me.
Yeah.
My dad was loyal to some of these guys, and that was the way it was.
Unbelievable. How about, your dad started the first senior tour event, and that was in 1980. Don January won it. You were the tournament chairman.
I was tournament director. The working guy. My dad was tournament dictator. So let's be clear on that.
So you were the hands-on guy. You put the field together.
And Dougie, well, with the PGA Tour, they pretty much set the field.
But this was the very first senior event.
Senior Tour tournament, besides the Legends, that was a team event in Texas, I believe.
Right.
That was a better ball event. So this was the first team.
Okay, January won it. And he was still pretty competitive back in 19.
He was still on the big tour.
Some of these guys, unfortunately, didn't play much golf, Jimmy.
It was amazing. Yeah.
They had a long drive competition. We're going to tell some tales out of school. Okay. See if he can do it in the next 30, 40 seconds.
We had a driving contest. Now, remember, a lot of these senior tour pros had not played golf in 10 years between the age 40 and 50. They really weren't playing that well. So I had a driving contest, and I had a walkie-talkie, and I had one of our members out giving me the yardage. And he would call back, J.A. Bear, 222 yards. Gardner Dickinson, 216.
They were hitting 6 irons. I'm only
kidding. No. So I went behind a tree, and I said, Ray, add 20 yards to every shot. This is not good. And he did. So we upped it a little bit. But they just hadn't played tournament golf.
Right, sure. Right. Well, on the equipment and everything else. 1980, we're talking, a little...
Persimmon Woods.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, sure.
Yeah, like I say, today these guys are hitting, 220?
Sure.
7 irons or something. Yeah. Unbelievable. Hey, guys, thanks very much. Stay with us. We're going to come back and wrap things up from the historic Atlantic City Country Club in Northfield, New Jersey, right back here on Inside Golf.
Stories everywhere at the Atlantic City Country Club. 100 years plus of golf and its many personalities will do that to a place.
Oh, no!
What?
Mandy keeps sending me pictures of the girls' shopping trip to Monco.
Why did you tell him you couldn't go again?
Because I told him that we needed to catch up on housework.
When I got back from the Gulf War, I was afraid to leave my house for 5 years. Clearview Hope and Renee Powell saved my life.
When I started Clearview Hope, I wanted to do all that I could to help our nation's women military veterans.
Renee, with Gulf, you have empowered all of us, and we just cannot thank you enough.
The best stories end in thanks. Share your story at thankspgapro.com.
My favorite core value is sportsmanship, integrity and honesty,
respect, seeing what they do differently that I do,
courtesy, I like helping people a lot.
Integrity and perseverance are one of the big ones that are my favorite. So.
The first tee of Greater Philadelphia, where golf is more than a game.
Well, that's going to do it for this week's edition, a special edition, we could say, of Inside Golf. We want to thank the Fraziers for joining us again back at your old home, your stomping grounds, Atlantic City Country Club. Doug and Jim, thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Sharing great memories of, and Bobby Shepherd, but memories you guys had, first of all, of your dad, and what a pleasure it is to sit here. You don't have enough time, I don't think, on one visit to kind of appreciate what has happened here at Atlantic City Country Club over the years. And you guys, of course, lived through it as you did, Shep, back in the day. So it's good. Can we do it again?
Love to.
We got more stories, Dougie, yeah. I know.
It'd be fun. I can't wait.
Unbelievable. Thanks for joining us here from the home of the Birdie, Atlantic City Country Club, with the Fraziers and Bob Shepherd. I'm Harry Donahue. And remember, no matter how bad it's going for you out there, don't pick up. See you next time on Inside Golf.
Inside Golf, now celebrating its 20th season, is presented by Destination Monco Golf. 54 courses, 300,000 yards. Check them out at MoncoGolf.com. By the First Tee of Philadelphia. The First Tee helps young men and women become better golfers, but most important, better people. Get involved. Visit thefirsttphiladelphia.org. By the Golf Association of Philadelphia, GAP, celebrating amateur golf since 1897. By Jersey Man Magazine, it's a Jersey way of life. And by Philly Man Magazine, bringing it to Broad Street. And by Inside Golf's partner since 1998, the Philadelphia Section PGA, experts in the game and business of golf. Take time to thank your local PGA golf professional.